Welcome to the Startup Grind.
How are you?
Good, how are you?
I'm great.
Awesome. Are you guys excited?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So let's get started.
Excellent.
Okay. Let's get a little bit of background on you. Like maybe when, kind of, where did you grow up? Where did you go to school? Just a little bit of that.
So I grew up on the East Coast, Alexandria, Virginia, which is not the hub of computer gaming at all. I went to the perhaps nerdiest high school known to man. It was called the Thomas Jefferson High School for Science and Technology because they needed to add as many extra nouns to the title as possible. During my high school experience, I didn't date because I went to a high school like that. But during that time, I spent a lot of my extracurricular activity running Dungeons and Dragons games, which also ensured that I didn't date. That actually prepared me for a life of game design because I was frequently what's called the game master or the dungeon master, as coolly as it's called, the DM. Who knew that? Oh. Because none of my players ever want to take the time to run a game themselves. Just running a D&D game is actually a lot of work. It's a lot like what I do now, but for computer games. So I grew up in Virginia. I realized that I didn't want to be a teacher or a lawyer. I wanted to write for a living. And they suggested that I actually go out to California and actually try and find a computer game company out there. So I sent my resume to a company called Interplay Entertainment because they were starting up a D&D division, something that I had a lot of experience with. And I went past my first interview with flying colors, and they said, hey, well, we've got a job for you, or you can make an exciting $22,000 a year. And to me at that time, that sounded like the best deal in the world, because it sure beat $50 every 2 months. So I'm like, I'm going to California. So I went out there, and then for the next 20 years, I was a computer game designer.
So what did you do?
I put you to sleep, didn't I? Put you to sleep. You look so sleepy right now.
So what influenced you to become, what was the influence that got you to become a video game designer?
So the influence was that I just loved doing it. It was actually my hobby. And then I did it so much that the pragmatist in me said, I'm sure doing a lot of extra work, but it would be nice to find some other use for all this stuff that I created. So what I do is, whenever I make my own adventures or modules for my players, I would actually try and type those up and put them in a pretty format, and then submit them to various gaming magazines. And let me tell you that, you can get rejected a lot. They were like, you have no sense of story, or pacing, or module, you've seen it 100 times before, and I'm like, thank you so much, but here's another one. I'm going to keep trying, and eventually I'll wear your resistance down, just like they did. And eventually, around the 30th rejection, one editor told me to stop submitting something. He's like, I haven't looked at your last submission yet. You keep sending us stuff. And it was a very short, terse letter. And that was kind of an eye-opening experience. It's actually one of my co-developers today. We actually work together now. It's totally crazy. But it turned out eventually somebody got desperate, just like dating, where they were like, you know what, this guy keeps sending us stuff, and we need to have a certain module out for Q1 of next year. Why don't we get the crazy package? And they called me up, and they sounded really enthusiastic, and they're like, you know, Chris, we're going to give you a prime opportunity here, make your work see the light of day. I'm like, oh, that sounds great, Bruce, I'm awesome. And then I did it. And they were actually really, really happy with it. And then so were the players. And then eventually I got more work and more work and more work. So basically, I just kept swinging and I didn't stop until I actually hit the ball.
So can you share with us more about your journey at Obsidian?
Yeah, so when I was at Interplay, I worked there for about 10 years. And Interplay had kind of fallen on hard times. Their CEO had left. They'd been taken over by the French. Which rarely happens in Man Wars in Asia. But eventually it got to the point where we were turning out games faster and faster, but it never seemed to help the overall health of the company. Things just looked kind of grim. So one of my bosses at the time ended up leaving the company, and I really enjoyed working with him. So I was like, well, if you're leaving, then I'm going to quit too, because I don't really see any other point being here. And he's like, hold on a minute, give us some time. I'm like, okay. So I waited a month, and then I got a call from him. And he's like, by the way, would you like to be an owner of a new company? And I'm like, what? And then, yes, that's how my exciting journey into Obsidian Entertainment started. So I became the creative director for Obsidian, which is kind of like being the design guy there. We're giving advice and information, trying to mentor young designers to find their way through life, just like I did.
So you worked on a variety of design projects, from Interplay, Black Isle, Division, to co-founding Obsidian, and now.
I worked on hundreds of projects.
I know you did.
I heard that list. I'm like, wow, exhausted me just hearing it.
There was so many. And now with Kickstarter, working with Laren Studios?
Yeah.
Is that? Where do you get your ideas and inspiration for, where does that all come from, like for the games?
Caffeine. And when caffeine fails me, then I have a setup in my living room, which is very much a bachelor pad, because it actually has a huge TV on one wall, and then a rowing machine in front of it. And what I do is I watch movies while working out until the endorphins start to kick in.
Wow.
And then I try and use that as inspiration for like, wow, you know, I've got all these ideas right now, just with like taking my mind away from the computer and like starting sort of like doing movie meditation. Also, I try and read as much history as possible, especially nonfiction, because it seems to me that real life events are so far stranger than anything science fiction could dream of. The craziest science fiction story like pales compared to real history. Humans have done so much crazy stuff. I try and do a lot of reading nonfiction and then switch off to a fiction title now and then usually related to the genre that I'm working in. Like if I'm working on Fallout, for example, I might be like watching like the Road Warrior movies, for example, or a Boy and His Dog movie, even though it's kind of hard to find. Or I might be reading like science fiction books like Wool that actually deal with the post-apocalyptic atmosphere and like, okay, what have they already done? And how can I do something different but yet see the strengths in what they did. So it's basically just trying to be well-read and try and expose yourself to a lot of influences and not just games. You don't want to limit it just to games. Otherwise, that sort of limits your creativity.
So when you're rowing and you're working out and you're getting all this inspiration, do you like have a notepad next to you and then you're like writing things down or writing it on your hand?
Which, by the way, is terrible without the rowing machine because obviously you have to stop rowing to write something down. So what I try and do is store like three ideas in my head, and then I'll quickly grab the notepad like every 5 minutes and write those things down. Or I found a better way to do it, which I just keep my iPhone set to never lock next to me, and then I turn the dictaphone function, and then I actually shout the ideas in the phone, put that down, and then at the end of the workout session, I just email those notes to myself, and then I put it. This is so nerdy. And then I put it into actual scrap file that actually has all my potential game ideas for the future I think would work for a certain project. So it's kind of crazy now that I went through the whole thing. That's really nice.
So what is the criteria for trying to determine the idea stage, whether or not the concept will sell well? Like, how do you know when you're working on something? Are you working on multiple things? Are you working on one thing at a time? And then how do you know which one to go with?
So games are kind of a tricky beast. Usually the formula for games is they want to always do titles within a certain franchise that's already proved itself, whether that's like Star Wars, whether it's like Fallout, Dungeons and Dragons, things that have a very long track record of being successful because, you know, that's less of a gamble. If you're trying to do a brand new independent title, that's a lot harder because it's really hard to get noticed. Because there's so many things on Steam to choose from. If you're trying to kickstart it, it's hard to get attention drawn to Kickstarter. And I hear from indies and small developers almost every other day about trying to find ways to actually get their titles more into public attention. And it's a real challenge. But usually the way, I'm in a bit of a lucky position because all the games I work on have already been sold. like either they've already been internally approved by a publisher, or they already got funding, and that's why they're talking in the first place. There's only been a few instances where sometimes a company will want me to help pitch an idea, and but usually it's something that they've already sold.
How long does it take from start, like, idea to, like, finish, like, approximately?
Okay, so, I work on role-playing games, which is what Dungeons & Dragons is. That games like that can take anywhere from 2 to 3 years to make, which is exhausting. And I will say that I do enjoy working on smaller projects more, just because, you know, if you get something done in 5 or 6 months, you get the feedback from it pretty quickly. You can figure out what you did wrong and basically fail faster or succeed faster. And I sort of appreciate projects that allow a much more rapid turnaround for the amount of time that you invest in. Just spending 2 or 3 years of your life on a title, like, sometimes it doesn't always come together, and it's like kind of heartbreaking.
Can you talk about the UI design of the game? Like, how do you know, like, do you guys follow a certain structure, or what is, like, is there a traditional way of the UI, or any kind of tips on that?
The user interface usually depends on what type of game you're trying to create. Most of the design that I do for games involves dialogue mechanics. And the way, even dialogue mechanics have their own interface about them. And there's a few important rules to keep in mind. One is that they usually want to always have a dedicated UI designer, no matter what, that person's goal. And if they have art skills to boot, that's even better. On more recent projects, we actually had a dedicated UI designer and a dedicated UI artist both working together. And that is wonderful, because the UI is basically how the player communicates with the game. And if that language is messed up, then their experience is going to be pretty much trashed. But for example, things to keep in mind with dialogue interfaces is we try and make sure that the player's tone is always consistent, that the emotional range of the responses always goes from, hey, I'm a lawful good paladin, I know I want to just do good all the time and follow the rules, down to, I'm going to kill this guy. And make sure that you have that range. Every time there's a dialogue note, it always follows that emotional range every time the player actually hits that note.
I know you kind of talked about this a little bit, but a team plays an important role in the success of a game. How do you build a team? Like, how do you start with a designer? Is that where you start? Like, who's the start?
The ideal way is you set up a leads team that's composed of every single discipline that you need for the title. And so, for example, when we're doing the very small downloadable content packs for Fallout New Vegas, we have, like, a lead animator, the concept artist slash lead artist. We have lead designer, lead programmer. We even brought with a QA lead in as well. All the disciplines that need to be represented. We would all sit in a room and hash out the common vision for the game. And the reason we did that is because there's really nothing more dangerous for a game or any project if the leads don't see eye to eye as soon as production starts. So what we do in that sort of pre-production phase is we'd all just sit in the room, discuss the pillars for the title, like, hey, what's the important gameplay experience we're trying to deliver here? Like, do we want survival horror? Do we want, like, kind of like schlocky sci-fi, 50s crazy, you know, tech as part of our theme for the title? And then we agree, like, hey, what type of weapons that support that? What are the type of animations that support that? Like, is a thief character going to have enough to do? Is a combat guy going to have enough to do? Will the modders have enough additional content so when they go off and make their own games based on this material, do they have fun stuff to play around with? And then once we all sort of agree on that menu, then we bring the rest of the team in. We sort of do a presentation and go, hey, here's your 2-hour PowerPoint where we walk through every major character, what their story arc is, and the area designs, and where the player's going to be exploring, and why the CLC is going to be cool, and what you shouldn't do in it. And then after that, we're like, and let's start building some levels and maybe some game content. But if you have any questions, please report to your lead.
So that being said, creating this team, there's so many different creative people involved. How do you deal with, like, their creative differences? Like, what if they don't agree? Like, how does that work?
Is there, like, I'm so glad you asked. So there's this word I love called hierarchy. And what it does is, there are creative differences, someone always has the power to say yes or no. And ideally, everybody in that hierarchy should respect that structure and realize that, hey, you know what, if Matt and Trey want to make a South Park game, you probably should listen to what they have to say, and when they tell you not to do something, don't do it, because they know it's not perfect, and you should respect that and help enforce the design decisions, because guess what? You know, they have, you know, 14 plus, 15 plus years of getting it right. I mean, it just makes sense. So generally, from a project standpoint, you want to have that hierarchy structure in place where what we do is generally at the top of the food chain is the product director, who may not be like a producer or a manager or anything, but he's the one or she's the one who has the overall vision for what they think is going to be fun about the game, and everybody beneath them is designed to help support that vision. And basically, the project director's goal is to make sure that vision is communicated, that all the leads understand what they're supposed to do, and from then on, it usually becomes like lead designer, and then like you might have a creative lead or a systems lead or an area lead, and you have like senior designers, intermediate designers, junior designers, associate designers, intern designers, but ultimately everybody knows who has the power to say yes or no. And I don't mean that in a fascist way. But generally, the best way to go about it is to be sort of a benevolent dictator, in the sense that you should never be on a project where you don't feel like it's okay to speak up if you see something wrong. Because if you don't encourage someone pointing out a flaw or a bug or an issue, you're actually not doing your job as a leader either. So what you want to do is allow everybody to feel safe in providing critiques. And you want to train them what a critique is versus, man, this door opening mechanic sucks shit. And they're like, well, could you actually break that down into a technical critique? It's like, well, I'm used to the action button in most games being able to open doors, but the way you've designed it, I have to press the start button to do it, which makes no sense. I'm like, oh, okay. Well, that's a critique versus, just complaining. And if you teach your team how to provide critiques like that and genuinely listen to them and provide feedback, I think that creates a great environment for just making a good game. And I know all the times that when I was a project leader, generally I followed like the rule of three, where like if three people brought up an issue independently, I'm like, that element probably is flawed and should go away.
I like that one.
I like the rule of three.
Is there any themes that you enjoy working on the most? It's starting to cut me off.
When it comes to themes, it depends on the game. Usually, it's an examination of what that particular game is. Like when I was doing Star Wars, for example, I don't know if I'd really call this a theme, but I actually wasn't super excited to work on a Star Wars title. I'm like, oh my god, Star Wars. And I'm like, there's not going to be really deep characters. And can't stand the Force. Force is ridiculous, especially now. And then after a week of thinking about it, then I'm like, well, why do I hate the Force? I'm like, well, I don't like the predestination aspects. Like, I think it's overpowered. I think the Jedi are arrogant and stupid. I think the Sith and the bad guys actually make some good points. I mean, they did bring order to the universe. And that's not a bad thing. And then I'm like, well, what about a character that was the voice for all this, and actually critiqued the Force throughout the game. And then I got really excited. I'm like, oh wow, this could be a little bit subversive. This is kind of fun. And then that actually ended up being the theme for the game, where literally like one of the companions in the Star Wars game actually questions the whole notion of predestination and the Force, and whether it's actually a really good thing that Jedi and Sith surrender themselves to it, because it doesn't seem like the Force really has our best interests at heart. It seems like it's something else entirely. And if so, maybe you'd be a stronger person for breaking away from it. And then that's a theme that I don't think ever would have happened had it not been a Star Wars game. So it depends on the title.
Do you have a favorite all-time game that you play or that you worked on?
When I was very young, like 35, there was this strange-looking game in the computer store called Wasteland 1, and it looked like a role-playing game, but I wasn't sure because the packaging was really bad. But after I played like Bard's Tale 1 and 2 and 3 and all the other fantasy role-playing games, I didn't really have any other role-playing games to play, so I'm like, okay, well, I'll give Wasteland a shot. And Wasteland was incredible. Like, it allowed you to sort of traverse this kind of like post-apocalyptic environment, but like you could fight giant bunny rabbits, you could like transfer your consciousness inside an android's brain and then use your intelligence to actually fight your way out of situations. And just, and you could even clone your own party members. So like I had this Russian, like Russian heavy weapons expert in my party, and I'm like, I want five of that guy. And so it's like broken off 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And man, they were pretty devastated. But the game allowed me to do all these things. And I was blown away because I hadn't seen a role-playing game with that level of freedom in a really long time. So when the Kickstarter rolled around, and Brian Fargo for inXile was doing, it's like, this is Wasteland 2. You know, it's all the things that we wanted to do for a sequel, but publishers just weren't coming on board and didn't want to finance it. And then he saw a blog post from me where I talked, you know, so excitedly about the first game. He's like, hey, Chris, would you be interested in working on it? I'm like, hell yes, I would. And so he just brought me on board, and we went from there. And that's one thing I love about Kickstarter. It allows for sort of collaborative efforts like that. I felt that dealing with inXile and Brian Fargo with a Kickstarter, it was a lot easier just to agree to work together versus contracts that sometimes happen with larger publishers. And Kickstarter also has much more of a collaborative community effort about it. Like, I feel like all the Kickstarter companies kind of watch out for each other and help each other, as long as they're not running campaigns at the same time. So that's kind of nice. It's kind of more of a friendlier atmosphere.
How has gaming evolved over the years, and what surprises do you think are in store for us in the future?
Let's see. So first off, tons more voice acting, which is not a bad thing, but it does require you to lock down your story a lot faster. Also, there is a new rise in VR games. The only challenge with VR games is that they haven't quite solved the what if the VR game moves the camera for you, because then people vomit a lot. So a lot of the games for VR have to be very stationary experiences, like you're in a room or you're in a tiny ship, but you can't move around a lot. And then the other problem is just I think that they're still solving some of the latency issues with that, but they're getting better, so I'm kind of curious as to where the technology goes. Also, outside of the actual game design arena, the whole idea that you can actually, there's actually a mechanic now with either Kickstarter or Indiegogo where you can actually go ask the players directly if they would finance a game. That's huge, because normally it would only be one person or maybe a handful of people at a larger publisher saying, we don't think this game is worth our time. And that could be for very good reasons. It was a small title, like it may distract their QA department or their marketing team, but it wasn't worth their time because it was going to raise the big dollars that they saw. But if you ask the players, and you're asking for a much more reasonable budget, like, hey, I'm going to do like a $3 million game or a $4 million game versus, you know, a $30 million game, and then you tell the players who love your type of game, that, hey, we're not going to worry about doing it for consoles, like, we're not including all these silly bells and whistles that only, like, the global arena might want, it becomes a much easier sell. And to be honest, like, some backers for Kickstarter just get so passionate, they're willing to pay almost 5 or 6 times, or even in some crazy cases, like 300 times the price of a game, just to like receive like extra bonus stuff, like, you know, bound manuals or cloth maps or stuff they used to get in games in their youth. And I think the fact that crowdsourcing allows for that has been great. And last thing is, because it's much easier to get a game engine, and what I mean by that is, usually all games require, go figure, programmers to make it all run. It's really great when you have your idea, but if you have a programmer around to actually make it happen, you're kind of screwed. But then there's tool sets out there and engines out there like Unity and Unreal 4, where a designer can actually sit down and prototype gameplay and set up a gameplay experience, and they don't need as many programmers as, say, a full-time game, or sometimes they don't really need any programmers at all, which is pretty crazy, but it makes that game idea easier to get it out to the public, because that's one less area that you need. And then the absolute last thing, I swear to God, I'm lying this time. With Steam and digital distribution, that definitely changed things, because a lot of indie developers out there working in small teams, or even larger developers, they didn't need to go through a publisher anymore. Like, they could just call up a contact on Steam and go, we would like to get our title up on your service, and then It's really easy to get the game code up there, and people just download it whenever they want. They don't need a box in the store or, you know, burn all the Blu-rays and DVDs to actually get the game to market. They just do it through Steam, and that's an incredibly easy way to do it, and it's really painless. I mean, Steam makes a good chunk of change off of each sale, but man, it was really a game changer for the game industry, which is a horrible pun.
So, maybe someone in the audience, but I know there's a few gamers in there, that let's just say they wanted to break into the gaming industry. What are some tips that you might give them to get connected with someone like you, or what would be the best ways to, you know, get their foot in the door?
Come talk to me. That's first step. Actually, step zero is you don't really need to break into the game industry. What I tell people a lot is you can actually start making games right now, or you can start working on your portfolio right now. A lot of games that come out, they have this system called, like, I don't know if you guys have heard of the concept of modding, but what happens is some companies like Bethesda in particular is really good about this with Fallout and Skyrim. They'll actually release the actual game tools that were used to build the game, and then developers and the passionate designers out there will actually use those tools to create additional content for the game, which will then post up the internet, and people will play it from there. And that is fantastic, because if they love that game that much, chances are they're gonna wanna apply to that company one day. But if they actually have a chance to use their game tools in advance and actually build something of substance, and then actually put it up on the internet to be critiqued by other players, that's a great way to get noticed by developers and get hired. One of our success stories at Obsidian, there's a world builder named Jorge Salgado, a very tall Spaniard, very smooth talking. He actually, in his spare time, decided that he did not like how one of Bethesda's games was implemented. So for an entire year, possibly more, he rewrote the entire game using their own mod tools, and then he posted it on the net. He got like 100,000 downloads, maybe more. And the players, like, in like a 9.7 review score. He did like three iterations of that mod, fixing all the bugs, listing all the patch notes that he did. And the two advantages of that were, one, it was fantastic training. And the second thing is, when he applied to us, that meant we already knew who he was, because developers for a certain game always watch the mod forums for that game to see what the players are making with the engine, because usually the players come up with a lot more clever stuff than we do. So when he applied to us, we're like, oh my god, it's a Skiro. A Skiro's in the office, oh my god. And then he's like, yes, I'm here. And the voice is what sold it, but he already built up his resume, and he taught us a lot of cool stuff about the editor, and he was really great to work with in Fallout New Vegas, but that was because of the work that he put in being a game developer before he was actually hired officially at the company.
As a game developer, their lifestyle, what if they're gonna, like, obviously game developer's life is a little bit different maybe than...
Oh, it's crazy.
Right? So what advice would you give someone that is thinking about getting into this gaming life? Any tips or things that they might, you know, do to, I don't know.
So first off, always watch your health, because some of those passionate developers I've known actually put their health in danger working on games because they love doing it so much. What I try and counsel people to do is, if you're working more than 40 hours a week, and I know you probably want to, just be careful, because you can let relationships suffer, you can let your health suffer, and also recognize that when you're putting in that amount of work, especially if you're a game designer, you're actually creating a lot more work for everybody else that also has to maintain the content that you're producing. Like, if I need more of the area designers to support the story, or more creatures, or even quality assurance, has more stuff to test now because you put more stuff in the game. So always recognize that it's okay to put the reins on and then save that extra stuff for the sequel or the next installment. And just recognize it's not going to waste, but just sometimes less is better.
Do you have a personal mission statement that you live by?
Uh, Life is running out constantly, so I try never to pause because life is precious. And that was a pretty brutal realization for a 13-year-old to realize that Oblivion's waiting for me. But that's a great incentive, where you're like, wow, I better just keep working all the time because I don't want it to slow down for a second. I gotta make every second count. And also, I think that, I don't know if this is a personal mission statement, but when I was trying to become a game writer, I always knew that that's what I wanted to do, so I never stopped doing it, even though I got so many rejections. And I just encourage people that if they do hit those roadblocks, if you are really after the career that you want and you really love it, just keep trying, because there's a battlefield promotion out there waiting for you. There's an opportunity. You just gotta be there and have the work ethic to actually seize it when it arrives.
So never to give up. So the last question I have for you tonight before we take some questions and people can kind of come up and meet with you, is do you have, what's up for you, what's next for you? You know, there's a lot going on since we've been talking. You've had a lot of changes over the last year. So what's next for you in your career?
So eventually you get to a point where you mistakenly take success as making a lot of money, and it occurred to me that that actually does not make me happy at all. What makes me happy is working on interesting projects with fun people, and that alone will make me happy. So my goal is just to figure out how to keep doing that, and a nice thing is there's hundreds of projects like that going on. So it's been really gratifying to work with a number of people that I always kind of wanted to work with, but actually legally couldn't, which is really nice, because I can actually just drop a line to various people and go, hey, you know, I saw some blog posts of a game you're working on. Would you need any year of support? And like, often there's work I do where I don't get paid for it at all. It's just interesting work. I'm like, I would love to know what your pipeline is. I would love to see what your tools look like. What's your management style? What's your tasking stuff? All this stuff that I think when you're at a company for 10 years or if you're working with the same people for 15 years, sometimes it's really hard to see those other perspectives. And I was worried to an extent that there's a level of learning that you stop having at that point, because everyone has that one certain perspective and they're always sort of chasing that same problem. But if you're involved in 5 or 6 other different genres or games, sometimes something that you notice over here applies awesome to game number 3, or hey, there's a management style in game number 2 that I think would clear a lot of problems in game number 5. And having that sort of cross-pollinization is fantastic. And I'm really enjoying that. And also, it's just also a good foundation for when you have that range of experience and you figure out, well, I really like working with that team, and I really like working with that team, and that programmer over here is pretty cool, and he seems to know what I want before I even ask for it, then that becomes a good foundation for building a team in the future, or finding a way to unite all those three interests to make, say, potentially a pet project game that I would want to work on. So there's that. I feel like there was something more I was going to say on this, and I totally forgot what it was. But yeah, that's great. Yay, memory.
Well, thank you so much for coming and sharing with us your story. And let's give Chris a big round of applause.
Thank you guys so much for coming.